In our worship, he's actually the one that is the object of our attention. When we worship, God is the one who is seated above and we on earth, and we understand our connection to him. And so we need to guard our steps as we come in. Hey, be prepared in your heart. Don't come and treat worship like it's the pocket lint of your life. Don't treat God like he's worthy of only our loose change that we can cobble together at a moment's notice. I'm glad for the grace of God. I'm glad we can come just as we are. But in our growth and maturation, we should not have worship regulated to the vanity of our own selves. We should come in full view of who God is. And so we guard our steps. We keep our foot as we go to the house of God. Notice why here in verse number one. And be more ready to hear than to give the sacrifice of fools. God's worthy of a proper sacrifice. We learn that in sacrifice, they chose the pure sacrifice. They put time into the preparation of the sacrifice. They highly developed their approach to the sacrifice according to the instruction of God. And while I'm glad that we don't have to prepare that kind of a sacrifice, we're still called to care about the sacrifice we do bring. In fact, in New Testament language, the Apostle Paul drills down on this for us. In Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, he pleads with us and says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, in that context, that you present your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. So he does care what we bring to him. He does care how we present ourselves to him. He does care our heart and our mind and our attention are firmly focused on him. He is still God. He is still mighty God. He is still a holy God. He is still a jealous God. He is still the only God, and he's worthy of our utmost attention. And so we need to guard our steps. We need to guard our heart. We need to guard our mind. We need to be ready not to give a sacrifice of fools, but to really connect with the object of our worship. He says this at the end of verse number one, "For they consider not that they do evil." It's amazing how Christians today many times don't even allow themselves to be in an environment where they can be convicted by the word of God in the presence of God. We want things to be comfortable to us. We want ears tickled. We want affirmation about where we're at. We don't want to be challenged. We don't want to be called to a place where we are humbly prostrate before our God, where we're considering what might need to take place in our lives. They didn't even consider that they were people of sin. In worship, many times people will come before God parading themselves as though they are something to be desired. Well, God desires that we would be his children, but we really in ourselves have nothing to offer God. How many of you understand God doesn't need anything from us? He doesn't need anything from us. We should come considering the privilege that it is to enter into his presence because of the sacrifice that his son, the Lord Jesus Christ, has made for us. So we see that we should worship carefully. Again, if we are going to worship in a manner that is not full of vanity, we also need to worship attentively. We need to worship attentively. And sometimes our own mouth gets in the way of that. The writer here of Ecclesiastes drills down on that thought. Notice with me in verse number one, he begins it, "And be more ready to hear than to give the sacrifice of fools." In verse number two, he continues that thought, "Be not rash with thy mouth, and let not thine heart be hasty to utter anything before God. For God is in heaven, and thou upon earth. Therefore, let thy words be few." I think it's important to point out that God gave us one of these and two of these. We should probably do a lot more listening than we do proclaiming about ourselves. We have examples of this throughout Scripture. Of course, we like to pick on Peter. I think it makes us feel good about ourselves. But Peter was one of these people who tend to speak before he thought, who tend to interrupt the work and movement of God. There were several occasions where that happened in Scripture. Remember one at Caesarea Philippi where Jesus was asking the disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" And they were given their different answers. And then Peter spoke up when Jesus says, "Who do you say that I am?" Peter said, "Well, you're Jesus, you're the Son of God." And that was the appropriate time to respond to the question. But then when Jesus starts talking about going in and sacrificing, Peter speaks up and says, "You're not going to do that. I won't let you do that." And Jesus has to turn around and rebuke Peter and say, "Get thee behind me, Satan." There was another time on the Mount of Transfiguration where Jesus was illuminated in the glory of God, and there descended Elijah and Moses, or these figures that came down to venerate and show the ministry and the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Peter, instead of absorbing the moment, instead of learning from the moment, instead of being in awe of just simply who God was, instead of worshiping the fact that Jesus Christ was his Messiah, he said, "I know what we'll do. We'll build three edifices, one for you, Jesus, and one for Elijah, and one for Moses." And Jesus has to calm him down. "Slow down, Turbo." Why? Because we tend to run our mouth instead of listening to the Lord. We tend to shell out our opinions instead of absorbing his truth. We tend to feel like our experiences and our knowledge carry more weight than the word of God, which he's given to us to learn of him and to know him and to live for him. And so we've got to be very careful that our worship doesn't fall into the vanity of our own words, but that our worship reflects the God who is the word. We should listen to him. Notice what the Bible says in verse number three, "For a dream cometh through the multitude of busyness." What is he saying? Well, a anxious and overactive mind leads to some weird dreams. How many of you had some dreams before in your life where you woke up and you didn't know where you are and you had to check the date and the time and figure out what was going on? Your overactive mind led to some things that weren't very consistent, weren't very organized, weren't very well developed. And in like manner, the Bible says here in verse number three that a fool's voice is known by the multitude of words. A lot of times we just open our mouth and we have no gospel filter and it just comes out and it reveals a heart of foolishness. The Proverbs warn against this. The Proverbs tell us that better it is to keep silent and thought a fool than to speak and basically remove all doubt. It's better to be silent. The Bible says, be still and know that I am God. And just like we like to dilute our life with busyness externally so that we can avoid dealing with the deep things God is calling us to, we also like to talk over him so we don't have to hear sometimes the hard things that God is calling us to. And so when we worship, let's not worship in vain by uttering our own words. Let's be quiet and let's listen to God work in our hearts. I don't know about you, but I'm an expert at arguing with God while somebody's preaching. Well, surely that's not what that means. Well, God, maybe that's for another person. Well, God, maybe I think I'm fine in this area. Well, God, and we rebuff him and we rebuke him and we push him off. Hey, when we come and we open up the word together, when you're worshiping God in your private life and opening up the scriptures, sit with his word for a while before you just dismiss it as something you don't need. Let him truly speak to you and guide you. Let him be the word. We need to worship attentively. We also find in our passage of scripture this morning that if we are going to worship in a way that's not full of our own vanity, we need to worship faithfully. We need to worship faithfully. In our passage here, we find that it talks about oaths. Notice with me as we drop down to verse number 4. When thou vowest a vow unto God, defer not to pay it, for he hath no pleasure in fools. Pay that which thou hast vowed. Better is it that thou shouldest not vow than thou shouldest vow and not pay. Suffer not thy mouth to cause thy flesh to sin. Neither say thou before the angel that it was an error. Wherefore should God be angry at thy voice and destroy the work of thy hands? See, well, what does this have to do with worship? Well, worship, real worship, should put us in a place of responsiveness to God. Worship isn't just a ritual. Worship is an acknowledgement that there is a great God that I need to present myself to as a living sacrifice. There is a God who has callings and purposes and direction for me, and I should follow his direction in my life. If we come to worship and then we walk out the doors unchanged and unchallenged, then have we really worshiped? If we've come before the presence of God and we don't see who he is or what that means in our life, if we have no stirring of the Spirit bringing us from a point where we have no growth to a point where now we're producing fruit, then what good is worship? It's just vanity. And so often, even in the Old Testament, true worship was associated with times of oaths to God. Such an example of this took place in the books of Samuel with Hannah, Samuel's mom. Hannah had a rough time in her marriage relationship to Hananiah. Hananiah had multiple wives, Hannah being one of them. And Hannah's adversary in the home was Peninnah. And Peninnah gave Hannah a very difficult time. Peninnah had multiple children with her husband. She was favored because of that. It was obvious in the home, and it was very hurtful to Hannah. And Hannah, in her hurt, as she went to the place of worship, fell down before God and began to pray so passionately to God that her mouth was moving, but no words were coming out. Eli, the priest, saw this and jumped to the conclusion that Hannah had become drunken. So he approached Hannah in order to find out about her drunken state. And Hannah responds to Eli and says, I'm not drunken, I'm sorrowful, I have no son. And in that prayer, she was making an oath to God in worship to him. She said, if you will bless me with a son, I will give that son back to you. We find that when Samuel was born, because God indeed did bless Hannah with a son, that at the age of 12 years old, Hannah took Samuel back to the temple to dwell in the temple. She gave her son back to the Lord. He dwelt with Eli and began to learn from God his calling as a prophet of Israel. It's an example of such an oath that came from a connection of worship. And if you can come to church, let me say this, and I hope it drills home to all of our hearts, this man standing up before you this morning. May we not be able to come perpetually to worship and never enter into any oaths or promises with God. We should see his blessed promises in his word. We should see his callings in his word. We should see his direction in his word. And we should respond by saying, God, I'm committing myself to follow you. And then by his spirit and in his power, we should keep that oath as a sign and signet of our worship to him. If we come to church and we're never stirred, we're unchanged, we're untransformed, we never commit to God, God in the area of his callings, then have we really worship, or is all of this just mere vanity? Like the vanity of pleasure without God, like the vanity of wisdom without God, like the vanity of projects without God, like the vanity of relationships without God. Is worship also mere vanity in our lives? Or is it a place where we're guarded and prepared? Is it a place? Worship, is it a place in our lives where we're silent and we actually hear from him? Is it a place where we're prompted by his spirit to enter into decisions and to keep those decisions faithfully as an expression of our worship? Being that living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is our reasonable service. We're called to worship faithfully. Lastly, this morning, as we consider worship not just being a vanity of our own flesh, but something real and connective to God, we learn that worship should be done fearfully. We should worship fearfully. And by fearfully, I don't mean that we worship timidly. By fearfully, I don't mean that we worship as though we're some abused child that's cowering and shaking before God, our Father. But we should recognize some things about him and behave properly. The writer here says things like this. Notice with me as we go back to verse number 2. For God is in heaven and thou upon earth. We've got to recognize that. We should stand in awe of God if our worship brings God down to our level where he's just a spiritual party buddy. He's my bestie. Hey, listen, I'm glad that Jesus is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. I'm glad that we're co-heirs with him, but make no mistake about it. Jesus is God. He's holy. He's righteous. He's exalted. He's lifted up. He's in heaven. He's at the right hand of God. He's worthy of our awe. And we need to get back to an awe of God again in our lives. I'm glad that he is a father that's not abusive, but he is a father that's corrective. In fact, the expression of his love to us is that he does correct us and chasten us. Hebrews chapter 12, beginning somewhere around verse number 6, the Bible says, "The Lord loveth who he chasteneth, and he scourgeth every son whom he receiveth." It goes on to say that no chastening at the present seemeth enjoyable. But after that chastening works the work it's intended to do, it produces fruit in the child's life. And that's God's objective in our life, is to produce his fruit in our life. In order for his fruit to be produced in our life, we need to worship in fear of him and in responsiveness to his correction in our life. And we find that that's what the author says here. Notice with me again, verse number 7. Verse number 7, chapter number 5. For in the multitude of dreams and many words, there are also diverse vanities. But don't worship in vanity. Don't worship in the diversity of words and dreams. Worship in the fear of God, but fear thou God. Fear thou God. We have this very laissez-faire attitude in Christian culture today that Jesus is my homeboy. I've seen this on a t-shirt. This very haphazard view of our approach to worship, this very low view of who God is, this very almost incarnate sin view, like Jesus came down and because of his grace, he just was connected even to the vanity of my own life. Hey, can I just say something? There was nothing vain about Jesus at all. He did not operate in vanity of the flesh. He operated in obedience to the Father. May we have a high view of God as we worship Him. Worship Him in fear. How's your worship this morning? Is it just another checklist on your list of superstitious practices in order to make you feel good about your life? Because that was the observance of the author here. He observed many times a worship that was just as vain as pleasure, was just as vain as wisdom, was just as vain as projects, was just as vain as anything else that we do in our life without God. His instruction is don't be vain in your worship. In your worship, be careful. In your worship, be attentive. In your worship, be faithful. In your worship, be fearful. Be in awe of our great God. Let's all stand this morning with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, no one looking around. Heads bowed, eyes closed, no one looking around. Maybe you're here this morning and you're struggling in your worship because you're not a child of God. You've not dealt with His sacrifice in your life yet. The reason we worship God is because He is the God of sacrifice. He's the God who gave Himself for us. He's the God who provided for our salvation. Have you seen your need for salvation? Have you seen that you're a sinner before God and you need a Savior? He loved you. He came from heaven to earth as a man, still being 100% God, sinless, perfect, as the perfect sacrifice to take your place and my place on the cross. He died for us, and He didn't stay in the grave. After He paid the price for our sins, He rose again the third day from that grave, defeating sin and death, and offers His eternal life to us as a free gift, not something we have to work for, not something we can attain to, but a free gift in which when we exercise faith in Him based upon the Word of God, we can have that eternal life. Do you believe in Him this morning?